However, I'll take the opportunity to introduce to you Cliff Williams. Cliff is the Operations Maintenance Manager from ERCO Worldwide. He's located in Canada. He's a 30-year-plus veteran of the maintenance field, and that's actually all that he wanted me to say. However, never being one to stick to convention, I'll just point out to you that he's worked in the pulp and paper and steel industries, as well as with food giants such as Coca-Cola, Kraft and Wrigley. His present role allows him to help drive the maintenance performance at ERCO's plants in North and South America. I won't say any more, but just I did learn something about Cliff last night, and that is that there's a particular date that means a lot to him. That date is actually December 24th. I won't tell you what that is, but if any of you get the chance to offer Cliff a glass of red or a beer tonight, you may find out. Could please welcome Cliff to the stage, who's going to talk to us about creating the environment for improvement. Thank you.
Okay. As the beer is free, I don't think you have to wait and buy me a beer tonight, so I'll tell you what that date was. I happen to have three daughters, and they are all born on September 24th, all three of them. So if you work 9 months back to that, it becomes December 24th, so you know what I get for Christmas every year. Okay. So anyway, that's my little secret about me. I may wander in front of the screen because I'm used to wandering on stage, but I'll try not to. If I do, somebody just get a hook and pull me away, please. What I'd like to do today is just talk to you about a journey that we took in a paper mill in Canada some 15 years ago. And it was an interesting journey. And it was, the mandate was that I was to take what was a group of really skilled tradespeople and get them to become an engaged group, to become an empowered group, to become an involved group. They were really, really good at reacting, really, really skilled people. And they were tremendous, their skills were excellent, but they would fix things and go home. That was what they thought that their role was. The company needed to progress, and so they said, okay. I was hired into the role to try and move them forward. So when I thought about that, that shouldn't have all come up at the same time. Let's go back there. I thought about how am I going to do this? And I thought, well, I could talk to them about MTBF. And then I thought, really, no, that's not going to get what I want. I could talk to them about MTTR. But again, that really wasn't what I was going to get. RONA, return on net assets. No, they wouldn't understand that. I could talk IRR, they wouldn't understand that. So really, I wasn't really finding anything that I could use. But we did have a CMMS, and I thought, I'm going to use that. Then I thought, well, maybe we could do RCM, because that was just taking off in Canada in the early 90s. I thought, no, really, can't do that. And I thought, what I have to do is be a little bit creative and create our own system. And this was before Krista made the edict that we couldn't use any more acronyms. So I felt free to use acronyms in those days. So what I thought we would, there we go. I don't know why it's going through. Any ideas? No? Okay. So I thought perhaps we could talk about creating reliable asset performance. But somebody said, I don't think so. That's not a good acronym. And somebody else said, well, that's actually good for you because that's all you talk anyway. So that was, I said, okay, we're not going to use that. Now, hopefully we don't jump to this, but okay. Yeah. I don't know what we're going to do. Do we want to start again or something? If they're all going to do all that? Okay, we'll do it. We'll go straight through it. Okay. So we thought we would build up longer life cycles, sustained holistically, and then stopped. We said, okay, no, we're not going to use that. So what I suddenly realized was that I didn't want a program anyway. That isn't what I was looking for. But I didn't need a program to get the people involved and to move forward. What I needed was an environment. So I thought, okay, we'll embark on the journey of creating an environment for success. And that's what we're going to talk about today is what we did. The same methodology will apply whether you're mining, whether you're pulp and paper, whether you're steel. I used the same methodology when I worked through those different industries that Peter talked about. And but what you're going to see today is not something that you can take home and use right away. It's not intended to be that. What you're going to see today is something that will hopefully provoke thought and will get you to think about what you can do. Because if there was a silver bullet that was going to solve everyone's problem, I'd be selling it and making lots of money. And I'm not. I'm still working for a living, as I say. So there's no silver bullet, but hopefully this will provoke thoughts about what you can do back at your organizations. So have you heard any of these? We've always done it this way. Hands up if we've heard this. Okay, good. I don't have time to do that. Okay, good. That's not my job. Okay, good. Why? There are two people at the back. If you could tell me where you work, I'd like to apply because you didn't put your hands up at all. I want to find that place. If it exists, that's utopia. I would love it. But that's what we were typically up against. So to overcome these, we need to have the right environment. And if we don't have it, we have to create it. And as you see, CREATE is in large font, capital letters, and it's an acronym. Because despite what Krista says, and Krista and I have discussions about this, I really believe that Albert Einstein's definition of insanity, of doing the same thing every day and expecting different results, is definitely the definition of insanity. There's also another quote from Albert Einstein which says that you can't solve a problem with the same level of thought that created it. So you have to think at a different level. And that's what we're going to talk about. It's going to be creative. As maintenance people, reliability people, engineering people, creativity is not necessarily our strong suit. We like numbers, we like formulas, we like predictability. Creativity, we can take or we can leave. So what we're going to talk about today is a creative way of moving forward. So let's look how we change the environment, and we'll have a look at the acronym. Communicate, respect, educate, authority, trust, and exercise. Communicate. There's a need to talk, and there's a need to listen, and there's a need to respond. Communicating is not just talking. A lot of people think that talking is communicating. That's the minor part. A lot of people say, I talk a lot, and I tell them, that's fine, but I listen twice as much. Because that's where you can learn a lot if you listen. But you need to communicate, talk, listen, and respond. First of all, what we needed to be was, we needed to make sure that we actually spoke the same language. Because now, I had this vision that we were going to move forward, but was I speaking the same language as the people on the shop floor? Dave, can we run the first video, please?
Das hier ist mein Sektor. Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters. Das Gerät, das Überlebensradar.
Mayday, Mayday. Hello, can you hear us? Can you hear us? Can you... Yeah, over. We are sinking. We are sinking.
Hello? This is the German Coast Guard.
We are sinking. We're sinking.
What are you thinking about?
So you see, we really do need to be sure that we're speaking the same language. Because look at the trouble you can get in if we're talking different languages. All of these videos that we're going to see, yes, there's humor to them, but there's really a point behind them. And that is, we need to speak the same language. If I was going to get the people involved and have them work with me and actually drive the performance forward, I needed to be sure we were talking the same language. So we first started with memos. And I memoed everything. I memoed them to death. Every time we did something right, I put a memo on the board. Every time we did something right after something went wrong, I put a memo on the board. You know, and I had all these nice sayings about, it's not when things go wrong, it's how you react, and oh, it was great. And yes, a couple of chests went out, and you know, they read the memos, and it was okay. But I realized that I wasn't getting them involved. That was one-way communication. I really wasn't doing what I'd set out to do. So we decided we needed to meet, and we were going to meet every month, and there would be two-way communication. And the reason for that was I needed them to understand my perspective. Where was I coming from, so that they could join with me and move forward in the same perspective, and we're together. So Dave, if you could run the second one, please.
Again, this is the USS Montana requesting that you immediately divert your course 15 degrees to the north to avoid a collision. Over.
Please divert your course 15 degrees to the south to avoid collision.
This is Captain Hancock. You will divert your course. Over.
Negative, Captain. I'm not moving anything. Change your course. Over.
So, this is the USS Montana, the second largest vessel in the North Atlantic Fleet. You will change course 15 degrees north, or I will be forced to take measures to ensure the safety of this ship. Over.
This is a lighthouse, mate. It's your call. Hello, Captain? I think he's gone.
So, fair enough. We wanted to be sure we didn't hit any lighthouses. As much as I could be the captain and drive everything, really, I didn't want to hit any lighthouses. That was what I wanted to do. We wanted to be sure that we had the same perspective. And that was really important. So what we did, we set up a monthly meeting. And that was really the agenda for every meeting, except special meetings. And we'll talk about those a little bit later. But this is what we looked at. We looked at safety first. And we started off the very first time was that the Joint Health and Safety Committee member for maintenance had to present safety. That was one of the mandates that I made, was that they had to present safety. And we built on that, and in the end, we had the tradespeople calling in suppliers, rigging companies, electrical companies, and they presented to us. So we got them involved in that. And then the rest of the meeting went something like this. Okay, they've just built another paper mill in China. That's going to make our lives tough. They've got an equipment manufacturer in Eastern Europe. That's going to make our lives better. And they're still counting sheep in Australia. But okay, nobody said I wasn't brave. I threw that one up there to see what we'd get. But that's what we looked at. And then we looked at what was happening in North America. And then we had a sister plant in California. There was a new plant being built in New Mexico. And wouldn't you know it, but they shut down the plant in California. So that changed everything. Then we talked about new developments within the company, initiative updates, what was going on, where we are, and possible developments. Because the way I looked at it was that if I wanted them to join me on the journey and move forward, then they should know everything that I knew. We realized that there would be some things that were confidential that we really couldn't share with them. And I told them that, you know, that as much as possible, I would share with them whatever I could. And I meant whatever I could, not what I chose, but if corporate said that I couldn't divulge it, I wouldn't. If they didn't, I would. And that's the way we were going to progress going forward. So then we looked at respect. Because as I said, these are really, really good tradespeople. So we had to make sure that we had an environment where respect played a part. I tend to bring my life values into work rather than the other way around. And tomorrow I talk about a lot more about those types of things where our life values transcend into the workplace. But this was certainly one that I wanted to have. So you got to create an environment where you show that you respect their opinions, experience, and skills, and they must respect yours. They were skilled people. They had a lot of experience. They were really good guys. And believe it or not, I actually brought something to the party. So we needed to make sure that that respect was there. So we had to remember the three E's of respect, and we developed these. The first one was that it's earned. Now, some people believe that as soon as they get the manager's job, they get respect. Doesn't quite work that way. Typically, what you get is a little bit of authority and a huge amount of responsibility. Respect, you got to earn. So we have to work at earning the respect. It has to be equal. It can't be a love-in where every time they wanted something, we did it. It had to be that they would listen to what I had to say, I would listen to what they had to say, and we would build and go forward. We had a little mantra that we used to use, and that was challenge and build. It was totally acceptable within the organization to challenge anything as long as you were going to build upon it. You weren't allowed to challenge for the sake of challenging. You had to challenge and build because we respected each other. And then it needs to be exercised. This is not something that you put a plaque on the wall that says we will respect our people. That's not what it's about. It's about exercising that. It's no good saying we're going to respect our people and the first time they ask for something you say no. Or they suggest that you do something one way, you say no. It's not going to work. You have to exercise that respect. Listen to what they say. If you disagree and you want to do something differently, that's fine. Just tell them why you're doing it differently. The challenge with respect was that it can lead to a fourth E, and it's the bad E of respect. And that E is expectations. And that soon developed after all of this discussion and the memos and the involvement. There was expectations. There were expectations that they could get whatever they wanted, that there was a reward, that there was something in it, that they really could now expect things. So we had to have a discussion about respect and the fact that you cannot expect everything to happen that way. So we had a meeting, which we did every month. And that was the agenda. It was safety and Aretha Franklin. That was it. So I put that up on the wall, and they all walked around for a month saying, what the hell is that? And I didn't tell them any because we'd not had this discussion. They hadn't seen the previous slide. They had no idea what it was. So they kind of walked into a room that had a PowerPoint exactly like this, and as they walked in, I pushed a button. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. That's what we talked about, and that was it. I said, from now on, this meeting is about respect. And we talked about the fact that it had become an expectation, that no longer were we really respecting each other, now we were actually trying to usurp each other. And that wasn't going to happen. So it got close to the end of the meeting, and I told them that at the end of the meeting, they would respect one thing. And we carried on the discussion, and we got to the end of the meeting, and they all wanted to know what the one thing was that they had to respect. And I told them quite bluntly, this wasn't an option. They had to respect. And I think most of them expected it to be me, that I was going to say that they needed to respect me. But it wasn't. What I told them they had to respect was I had a job to do. My job was to run the maintenance department for that mill the best that I could. And they would respect that. They could question it. They could ask why I was doing certain things, why things worked certain ways. That was fine. But they had to respect eventually that I had a job to do. I would communicate as best I could, and hopefully we would get over any bumps, but they had to respect that. And for the most part, they did moving forward. It was a good discussion. It was a very heated discussion at one point where one side of the table was calling the other side of the table some nasty names, and I had to step in between them and say, you can't do that, that's not showing respect. And expletives were exchanged and things like that. It was quite interesting. But it was neat how many people were picking up, and we're going to bring the others along. So then we had a look at educate. And this first point may seem silly, but it really isn't that silly, and that's we only train people what they need to be trained on. Too often I've seen with companies, they'll ask, can we go on a training course? Oh, we need to go on a training course. We need this, that, and the other. And off they go on training course, because I got a training budget. If I don't use it, Go back to what we were going to use with the CMMS. As best we could with the CMMS that we had, are the Maximo people in here? Any Maximo people? Oh, good, I can really slag him off. Okay, great. No, we had Maximo, it wasn't that good. It wasn't that good. We had a very, very old version of Maximo that didn't help us very much. But wherever possible, we tried to get things like failure modes. What were the failure modes that were occurring? What were they things that we could train people on? And if we trained them, it would prevent it from happening again. Were the technologies that we needed to train people on? We had laser alignment, things like that. We did vibration pens in the early 90s, vibration pens, infrared guns, ultrasonic earphones, and that became the kit that people walked around to do a PM with. So But we were only going to train people what they needed to be trained on. The other challenge I had was I had to educate them about what I wanted to know. There were things that I needed to drive and things that I needed to use to lever upwards into management to get things. So I needed to know something, and so I had to educate them around that. I had to get them to understand that it was a two-way street. I needed information from them, they needed information from me for us to move forward. So I had to educate them around that. At the very end of the exercise, it took about 5 years to get to this point, but we were doing total work order costing. We would sit down every week in individual groups. It wasn't as a big group. We used to take it in area maintenance groups and pull them together and sit down and go over work order costing. We used to include the cost of generating a PO if it was required, the time that planning was involved, and showed them the real cost of that work order. The buy-in we got after we started doing that was incredible. They suddenly realized that what they thought was using six parts for this pump and cost, you know, $1,000, in reality, including downtime, all of these other things cost the plant $10,000. And we had a kind of an agreement was that if we could sell that to upper management, that we were actually saving this money by, you know, that the cost of the work order is $10,000. If we had some technology for $5,000, maybe we could use it. So that was where we needed to go with that. There were three P's of educating people. Are we training the right ones? Mark mentioned that, and Mark from Boeing mentioned that you can't train everybody on everything. So pick the people who are most, who fall into that sort of regime of, we had some people who really were interested in vibration analysis, so let them train vibration analysis. But what we tried to do was train everybody on something. What was it that they were doing that we wanted them to do better? So it may not have been a huge full-blown course, it may have been just a manual or something, but we tried to train people, train everybody on everything. It was pertinent, as I said, was it going to solve a problem? Was it going to help us? And was it practical? Yeah, we could buy six full-blown FFT vibration analyzers, but we're not going to use them. It might have made life a little simpler, but practical? Wasn't there. So we had discussions around this, and what I got thrown up in my face all of the time was, yeah, but you're talking about this, and you won't give us the tools. So I said, well, what do you mean by that? And they said, well, look at this Maximo system we've got. It's computerized reliability, asset performance, so except they just called it crap. And they said, it's crap. It doesn't do anything. You want failure codes? We can't use the failure code module. So I said, okay, fine. I'll go to the plant manager, and we'll see about getting a new CMMS. I went up to the plant manager. He said, no. Straight away, he just said no. He said, I don't believe you're using the system as well as you could be now. So until you prove to me otherwise, no. He said, I don't see your people. All I hear from your people is, oh, we can't use this system. I don't think they're trying. I don't think they're interested. I said, okay. So we had a meeting. We were big on our monthly meetings. And the next monthly meeting, the agenda was just that. Safety and maintenance quiz. And this is where it becomes interactive. And you show us your immense knowledge around maintenance. Because what I did, we had this as an agenda, and I invited the plant manager to the meeting. So he walked in, sat down, everybody looked at him, he looked at them, everybody looked at me, and it was one of those, well, what the hell's going on here? So that was fine. So then this came up on the board, and it was the quiz. Okay, so these were the topics, and these were the dollar values that you could get for answering the questions. So the first question was hydraulics for $100. Don't forget, this is interactive, and Krista has the $100 that whoever gets it right. Okay, Krista will give him the $100. Honestly, what is used to clean oil in a hydraulic system? Come on, shout. Jeez, come on, guys. I know it's after lunch, but you got to get going here. What's used to clean filters? Yeah, good. Good answer. Second question was bearings for $100. Okay. Along with the inner race, outer race, and cage, these make up a bearing. And the answer is rolling elements, roller, balls, everything. Good. You guys are good. Jeez, I'd love to have seen you before lunch. Gosh. And this one, is there anyone here from the paper industry? No, this is going to be really tough on you guys then. Sorry about that. You're not going to be able to answer this, and it's going to really blow your mind, but we'll try it anyway, and I've got patience. Is that okay? The wet end and this make up a paper machine. The wet end and the dry end. Good. See, and there's nobody works in the paper industry. Yet you knew more about that than hydraulics and bearings. Jeez, you guys are good. So anyway, we went on and we went through the $200 questions. Everything was fine. Then we got to this question, which was bearings for $500. So the question was, what's the cost of bearing replacements over the last year? $500. Ah, yeah, everybody knows that's it. $5,000. No. $15,000. Nope. And we had one guy, Dave, who was really a comical guy. He was the group comic, and he's sitting there, and he said, "What was too much?" And I said, "Ah, good answer. Yeah, but that's not the right answer." So he said, "What is?" So I said, "Okay, the right answer to this is, what don't we know?" And they looked at me just the way you're looking at me, like, "What the hell is he talking about?" But anyway, we went on. So we got to the next question, which was hydraulics for $500. What was the amount of downtime due to hydraulic problems? You know, 4 hours, 2 hours, too much. Dave's sitting at the back again. He gets this little smile on his face, and he says, "What don't we know?" I said, "Correct, Dave. That was great." So we go to the last question. And the last question was paper machine for $500. What was the amount of paper lost that could have been prevented by good PMs? And as a group, they all shouted out, exactly. So we had a long discussion about that. And on cue, as these guys were prone to do, they were very good at this. You give them a cue, they'd just drive right in. They started lambasting me about how we couldn't use the Maximo system, and it was a piece of crap, and that's why we don't have these things, because the failure codes are not there. We don't record all of these things. And great discussion, end of the meeting. Later on the day, get a phone call, come to the plant manager's office. Okay. First thing he says is, "I did not appreciate being sideswiped this morning. I really don't appreciate it." I said, "Okay, just had to do what I thought I had to do." He said, "Well, it worked." He said, "You get me quotes. I saw the interest that you guys had." He said, "Get some quotes, and if it's doable, we'll do it." And after that, we did. We went out, we bought a Canadian-based CMMS called Maintelligence, which is absolutely brilliant. I still think it's one of the best on the marketplace. It's absolutely brilliant. It's the type of system that if you put a sensor on the flush on the toilet, flush handle, and then you say that for every flush we use two pieces of tissue, it'll tell you when to change the roll. It is so good. It's a fantastic system. And that's what we had. And we moved everything to condition-based. It was brilliant. It was an excellent system. But we had got the education across, not just only of the guys, but of the plant manager. And that really was a big win for us. The guys really appreciated that. The goodwill and everything that got bought by the plant manager saying, yes, we could have a new CMMS was incredible. Now, A's I should have told you about. A's, there are three. I started with one and I couldn't do it, but I'd have to be Scottish and say it's create, but I don't want to do create. It's crap if it's Scottish. Any Scotsman in here? No? Yeah, they got one Scot. I'm sorry. But anyway, authority. Do they have the authority to do what they need to do? Very early on, I figured out that I was getting called in the middle of the night. And I was getting called in the middle of the night, not because I had to make some overall wonderful technical managerial decision, but just that I could confirm that they could do what they already knew they needed to do. They just didn't have the authority to do it. People had told them, "No, you got to phone Cliff, you got to phone, that's what we've always done. We've always done it this way. Phone Cliff, see if it's okay to do." So we talked about it and we said, "Okay, from now on, certain questions, do you know what the solution is? Do you know what the problem is? Do you know what the solution is? Do you know how long it's going to roughly take? Do you have the," you know, there were sort of five or six criteria that they had to answer. If the answer was yes, then go ahead and do it. Don't wake me up. We got to the point with this where they were allowed to call in contractors if they needed contractor help. They were allowed to call in other tradespeople if they needed tradespeople help. And at the very end of the system, very end of the journey, we managed to get the company to allow them to write POs for $200. Small little things, but boy, oh boy, oh boy. Did that demonstrate that we respected them and that we did all of these things? Absolutely. And did they abuse it? No. They'd got to that point where, you know, it was very late in the journey. There was no way they were going to abuse it. So a claim. We needed to let them know that we recognized when they did something well. We needed to make sure that what we were recognizing was relevant, that we weren't recognizing the firefighter. The person we were recognizing was the fire prevention officer, the guy who was walking around in a little trench coat with a notepad making notes of what needs to be done to stop things catching fire, because he's the guy I want on my team. The fire department telling me they've put out the fire in my house in 2 hours really doesn't mean a lot to me. It means my house is on fire. The guy who's saying if you do these 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 things, your house won't catch fire is the guy I want on my team. So we had to make sure that what we were recognizing was relevant, because up until that time, the fireman, you know, edict was there that my shoulder went out and the plant manager thanked him for doing a great job. We kind of told the plant manager, you don't do that anymore. We can't do that. We can't recognize what's not relevant to where we want to go. And then we decided we need to reward people. We had to make sure that the rewards are relevant. Giving an all-black sweater to a Wallabies fan is not a reward. It's an insult. So you had to be careful. In Toronto, we have hockey teams in Canada. And boy, oh boy. And you can't tell, you know, just by where a person's from which team he supports, because many years ago there were just six teams and sort of whatever your father supported. So you have to be careful, you know, and there are people that drive Harley Davidsons, and so a Honda insignia or cup is an insult. So we had to make sure of that. Other things that they don't have to be monetary rewards, but you have to recognize how people like to be rewarded. Some people like you to walk into a lunchroom in front of all of their peers and shake them by the hand and pat them on the back and tell them what a great guy they are and what a great job they're doing and everything like that, and their chest goes out and they're happy. There are other people who would readily punch you in the mouth for doing that. They don't want that recognition. They feel embarrassed in a room. So you have to understand what motivates your people. It's a thing called situational management. And it's really situational management is managing different people in different ways. So you have to make sure that the rewards are really relevant and you do what they consider to be a reward, not what you think is a reward. And the next is attitude, and this is a biggie. And the next two slides are going to be very busy. We'll go through them very quickly. Let's see if I'm doing for time. Yeah, I'm doing okay. But they're very, very important, because these turned out to be some of the most important things that I learned on this journey. And the Batari, has anybody ever heard of the Batari box? No. Where it came from, I have no idea. Just came across it on the internet many years ago. And the Batari box is just a very simple depiction. And really what it says is that my attitude affects my behavior. So if I'm in a positive mood, I'm likely to go and thank people for doing a good job. I'm likely to empower people. I'm likely to have a joke with people. I'm likely, you know, to include people. If I'm in a negative mood, I'm likely to pick on people. I'm likely to become argumentative. I'm likely to, you know, just be obstructive. And that's okay to realize that. But the real bonus of the Batari box is that what we don't realize is that our behaviors directly influence other people's attitudes. So if I go into work and I'm in a negative mood and I go up to the tradespeople and I'm negative, their attitude becomes negative. And lo and behold, their behavior becomes negative. So when they go to the operator and they want to talk to the operator, can I get your truck, can I get your plant, whatever, they're not doing it in a nice, convenient manner. They're being obstructive. And wouldn't you know it, it affects the operator's attitude and affects his behavior. And the next thing I know, he's coming back to me telling me, what the hell's wrong with you maintenance people? And so just realizing that that circle exists, we can do something about it. And that's what this next page is going to talk about. And this is not just work. As I said, I bring stuff into work from my life. I take stuff from work out to my home life. And you can apply all of these things to your home life as well as you can. Remember, your attitude, good or bad, affects everyone around you. Your workmates, the guys on your team, your wife, your kids, your neighbors, your in-laws. Your attitude affects everything. So remember that. Good or bad, you're going to get the reaction. So the next time you're in a negative mood, stop what you're doing. Try and figure out what's caused it. Was it somebody cut me off on the road getting to work today? I guess in the mining area, that's not a big problem. You know, not many cars on the road, but in Toronto, that's a big problem. You know, so was that what caused it? Did the football team lose last night? Robert and I's team are playing tonight in the UK, and we're in a playoff situation. One of us is going to be in a negative mood tomorrow. We're not sure which one. I hope it's him. But anyway, it's a negative. So you figure out why you feel negative and why you've done. Oh, it may be you're going to go home and you're going to barbecue steak. And when you get home, the wife is invited over, the neighbors, and you've got, you know, lasagna. Okay, so you're still a little bit peed off at that going into work. So then what you're going to do is consciously break out of that cycle by focusing on something positive. Okay, it was lasagna, but the wine was good. The conversation was good. And okay, the team lost, but they can win next year. This type of thing. So you break out of it. I have, when we talked about the three daughters born on the same day, two of them are twins, and they are now aged 14 years old. So they very quickly get me into a negative cycle. So what I do, I imagine them as 5 years old, and they're coming down the street holding hands, and it's what they used to be when they used to listen to me, when they didn't know absolutely everything. They just knew a lot of things, and that's my happy place that I go to break myself out of those cycles. And that's what you've got to do, is break yourself out of that negative cycle. If a colleague's stuck in a negative cycle, you can influence it. You can be negative back, or you can be positive. Just realize that. If a team member's persistently grumpy and rude, explore the reasons for that. Negativity with them, highlight the consequences of their behavior for the team, productivity, and more importantly, the effect it's having on them. We had a welder from London, England, that was working in the team, Sammy. And Sammy would work overtime all the time. You could, you know, Sammy, you'd say, Sammy, you want to work overtime? And he'd say, yes. You know, he just wouldn't say no. Didn't know how to say no. Couldn't say no. And he was very exuberant and out front and everything. And all of a sudden, Sammy went quiet. When we asked Sammy, well, you want to work overtime? Sammy actually said no. So there was something going on. He was in a negative cycle. So I asked Sammy, come up to the office. Let's sit down, close the door. Let's have a chat. So I said, what's up, Sam? Well, you see, what you mean, what's up? Because he speaks like that, because he's from London. I said, well, you know, you won't work overtime. You're not your usual self. He says, well, I've got something on my mind. I said, okay, Sam, tell me. He said, yeah, it's me and Susan, we split up. Now, Susan was his wife. Susan and Sammy were my friends. Other than working with these people, we socialized every now and again. That was another part of the team thing that we did. We built teams that way. So I knew Susan and Sammy well. I knew how much this was going to mean to Sammy that he and Susan had broken up. So I said, what's happened? And he kind of told me, and I said, well, you know that my first marriage ended in divorce. He said, yeah. I said, well, you know, when I was going through that, I felt worthless. I felt as if it didn't amount to anything. I felt as if I couldn't contribute, that I was less than a man and everything. And Sam said, yeah, that's the way I feel. I said, but you get over it. It's not you. It's not about you. For some reason in your life, you've reached a point where you and Susan need to go separate ways. It doesn't mean you're less than a man. So I told him about how I had now got married, remarried, and had twin daughters. I think they had just been born. And how I was happier than I'd ever been. And that maybe Sammy could get to that point too. So he sat there for a while. He cried. It was fine. We listened to each other. We talked to each other. And at the end, he said, thanks, Cliff. Now I see things through a different light. And yeah, I'll work overtime. You know, that was the first thing on his, when he said that, I knew Sammy was back. He was back on board. So there's nothing wrong with that. And as I say, it's not necessarily in the maintenance manuals, but your people are the people that are going to make a success. It's possible to get into a downward spiral where someone is grumpy to you, you get defensive grumpy back, so on. You can't, if you find yourself in that, say, stop, hold the discussion, let's press the reset button, let's go back to start again, and let's see where we're going on that. It happened to me, somebody kind of said, you really are in a negative cycle, and it really isn't you, so what the hell's going on? You're right. Stop, let's figure out what's going on. And last but not least is practice empathy at work. Not only will it get your colleagues out of a negative cycle, but also get you out of one. It's extremely difficult, if not impossible, to be negative and empathetic at the same time. So if you can strive for empathy, your negativity will disappear anyway. So trust. You need to trust them. That's the other thing. I think somebody talked about it this morning, is you need to be honest. You need to get that honesty out of them. Because if you can't trust them that they're going to treat you honestly, then you can't move forward. You really have to have that honesty. You know, so one of the other things is that when people resist change, you know, we always done it this way, we can't do that. It's because they're afraid of what's on the far side. They're not sure, so they want to be able to trust that you're going to be there with them. As you move forward and that change, you're going to be there, they can depend on that. But you got to have honesty. Dave, if you could run the video on this one, please.
Good afternoon, madam.
Yeah, I'm sorry, officer.
Can I see your papers, please? Hello. Mummy in a bit of a hurry, was she? Step out of the car, madam! Step out of the vehicle now!
So you see what can happen if they're not honest. You can get in deep, deep doo-doo. So honesty is really important, that you have honesty with the group. You're honest with them, they're honest with you. Because, you know, they send you off on a wild goose chase, you're not going to progress, you're not going to get there. So honesty is really, really important. But again, it's that trust issue. So they need to trust you and that you will support them. You know, at the end of the change, you're there for them. Change is really easy. Change is when something ends. The transition from the way it was to the way it is now is what's difficult. Change is really, really easy. You stop doing it. Now the transition in making what you've changed to work is the difficult part. And they need to be able to trust you, because it is fear that will drive or drive them to resist. There are three D's of trust. I like using threes of everything. Because I got three daughters all born on the same day, so I have three comments made of same letters. I don't know, it's something about me. Demonstrated, again, same thing, and I'll talk about this tomorrow as well, is that you can't just say that you're going to trust people. You got to demonstrate it. You have to have norms and everything that support this. And I'll go into it a lot more detail tomorrow. It has to be due. You can't just say, I want to be trusted. No, you have to do that. And the hardest thing with trust is that it actually has to be developed. It's over time. You can't click your fingers and say, we will now trust everybody. It doesn't quite work that way, because it's a mindset for most people. We're going good. So, as with everything, we had a problem, so we had to have a meeting. Because for every problem, there's a meeting, and there's a solution. And this was when my little kids were really young, and we were watching Bug's Life on the video, as it was in those days. So, Dave, if you could run the video, please.
I'm lost! Where's the line? It just went away! What do I do?
Help!
We'll be be stuck here forever.
Do not panic. Do not panic. We are trained professionals. Now stay calm. We are going around the leaf.
Around the leaf? I don't think we can do that.
Oh, nonsense. This is nothing compared to the twig of 93. That's it. That's it. Good. You're doing great. There you go. There you go. Watch my eyes. Don't look away. And here's the line again.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Soil.
Good job, everybody.
Now, the funny thing about that was just a video that I showed them. And if it wasn't 3 weeks later, and I walk into the shop, and there's a bunch of millwrights there, and two or three of them, and somebody obviously had said the buzzword, because there were two of them there. Look in my eyes, come around the leaf, come around. And it became the watchword in Atlantic, where people would, if anybody said we can't do it that way, or we've always done it this way, they would be, come around the leaf, come around. And it was amazing. It was a lot of fun, but it worked. So again, and I know you might find this hard to believe, but these are things that I actually did. Too much time, maybe. Maybe too much time. I don't know. So really what we need to do is exercise the environment, and as I say, I'll talk a lot more about that tomorrow in tomorrow's speech about the presentation about the skills you need to be successful. But you can run trends, you can show improvements, you can allow more authority. As I said, we got to the point where we actually allowed POs to be written, all those types of things. You can establish a vision to maintain the environment, but as I said, tomorrow I'll describe how that can be the biggest blunder you'll ever make, or the best thing that you'll ever do. But there's a very fine line between the biggest blunder and the best thing you can do. So you can do that. This is a sign that is in my office, and it's been in my office for the last 17, 18 years, taking it everywhere with me because I really believe it. And it's, you can't talk yourself out of a situation that you behaved yourself into. It really is, you know, you can talk as much as you like. They won't listen to your talk, they'll listen to your walk. If you do it, if you demonstrate these things, if you demonstrate the vision, then people will respect and will appreciate and will change. Because really, if you don't believe that people will change their behavior if you change the environment, then just watch this last video, Dave, please.
Weeks of painstakingly searching this rugged area the size of hills, finally some kind of reward, as behind me the soldiers gather and burn huge piles of coca leaves and marijuana. The drug barons themselves may have escaped the net this time, but their evil wares have not. And I think you better cut that. Behind me, smoke, soldiers burning drugs. There, soldiers, behind me, soldiers, rugged soldiers, the size of whales, burning drugs. Painstakingly. Behind me, painstaking barons burning lead drug soldiers in huge piles of whale nets. Woo! All right, that's the one, Jerry. Hey, let's go for a curry.
So, as you see, if you change the environment, people's behavior will change. I really believe in all of this. Anybody that knows me and has met me before will tell you that this is the way I am. I really believe that the people are your key to success, and you need to involve them and do all of these things. Again, I'm not saying every one of you takes this home and starts, you know, when you get back to the mine or wherever it is, having bugs life on there, but not suggesting that by any stretch. But hopefully it's provoked some thoughts as to how you can move forward. And the success that we had in that plant was second to none. It was excellent. And it was also a great place to work. So that's it. Thank you, and if you've got any questions, I'll answer them.
Thank you very much, Chris.
Got time for time for one question, I believe.
Brad from Iron Ore up in Newman. I just had a question. What was the catalyst for getting you in? Was it you sort of show that one of the plants had shut down? Was that the main driver, and the guys actually had a bit of a reality check that they were going to possibly close their plant, was it?
Yeah, it was a reality check. When that paper mill was built, newsprint was selling at $700 a ton US when it was being built. When we were starting to run a year into running, newsprint was being sold for $540. So there was like $160 had gone straight off the bottom line. And so we had to start to do things better. And the catalyst really wasn't that to do this. The catalyst was we had to do something, and we had to do something around that. And this was my kind of invention, because I realized that all of the other things that people were trying didn't work. You know, you can tell people so many times to put work orders in, give us information, give all of these things, and it doesn't work. You know, there were lots of things that didn't happen. You can have a, you know, walk with a big stick, but again, that doesn't get you where you, where we wanted to go, where I wanted to go. I'm not a command and control person. I will walk away from command and control's jobs. I've done that. That's why I've worked in so many industries. If I find that the culture is command and control, I'll leave. I've got no interest in working in command and control. So that was my, the catalyst was we had to really do something better or go out of business. The bankers were coming in and seeing everything. And that was my chosen way of doing it. Did all of the other people do it that way? No. And that was the other thing. We found out you could actually do it in your own group. You didn't need to have the whole plant doing it, even though we would have liked that.
Okay, thank you. Somewhere in there, we ended up taking a little bit more time than I thought we were going to. So, can I get you to join me in thanking Cliff once more for his presentation?